Here's the Precap to be able to legally fly over people as a Part 107 remote pilot. Number one, get a Mavic 2 or Phantom 4. Two, get the ParaZero SafeAir Plus Professional Kit. Three, write your application, including risk mitigation steps, and I'll go into some of the risk mitigations that I included in my application, so hopefully it will help you. Number four, upload your application to the Drone Zone portal. Five, upload the ParaZero ASTM documentation. And number six, wait about a month. I'm Matt Coakley, and this is a Blue Mantle tutorial. All right, so here it is, my certificate of waiver that I received about 2 weeks ago from the FAA that allows me to legally fly over people as a Part 107 remote pilot. I'm super excited about having this because of the types of shots that it will allow me to get. So that's the waiver, and I'm going to go through how to apply for one and get one yourself. This video is going to be really long, I think. And so what I'm actually going to do is include links in the descriptions to various time codes of the different segments of this video to be able to skip ahead or use the description to jump to those time codes to go over the specific parts that you want to cover when you're going through your application. Now, in this video, I am not going to tell you the word-for-word text that I used in my application. The FAA has specifically said that they will deny waivers that are copy and pasted. What I will say is that I will give some of the broad categories that I covered, and I'll even give some of the specifics of what I covered, and then you can go and understand these are the categories to cover, these are the specifics to cover, and hopefully that will give you enough information to be able to think through the steps yourself and put your own application together that will be something that can be granted by the FAA. A couple of months ago, ParaZero reached out to me and it was just too good of an opportunity to pass up. They sent me their product, the SafeAir Mavic Plus Professional Kit, so that I could show how easy the process is to obtain a 0.39 waiver. So that said, this is still my video and these are still my thoughts on how to obtain this waiver. And my hope is that it will help you guys be able to obtain your own 0.39 waivers. For those who are unfamiliar with it, 107.39 is the regulation in the United States that prohibits drone flight over people. At this point, the only way to be able to legally fly over people is to obtain a waiver to the 0.39 provision. Until recently, there had only been a handful of these waivers granted. As of the filming of this video, there are 83 waivers total. About 3/4 of the waivers granted were granted within the last year. So they're definitely increasing the amount of waivers that they are giving. And something like 40 of the waivers that have been granted in the last just like 4 months have been with the ParaZero system. So it's a really good system. The FAA is familiar with it. They are willing to grant these waivers as long as you demonstrate that by using the system as it's supposed to be used, and you have risk mitigation steps in place, the FAA is willing to give this waiver to people. Overall suggestions for applying for this waiver. Number one, be organized. I created my entire application in a Google document before I actually went into the Drone Zone portal and did the specific application. And basically the application came down to that document and the ParaZero ASTM documentation as well. Number two, be thorough. So the FAA has specifically said that they will deny applications that are not 100% complete. By being thorough, the FAA will know that you've thought through this and will be more likely to grant your waiver. Number three, if you do receive an RFI, a request for information, respond to it as quickly as possible, and that will help expedite the finishing of your application. I'm gonna go through the steps to apply, and then once I get into the steps to apply, I'm going to give you some of the information about the specific parameters and risk mitigation steps that I included in my application. So step one, you will need to have an account with Drone Zone, which is faadronezone.faa.gov. And if you're a Part 107 operator, you should already have this account. To be able to apply for this waiver, you need to have the specific information for the drone that you plan on using. Because this is a waiver that is contingent on the risk mitigations, and the risk mitigations are contingent on what drone you're using and what parachute you're using. So you have to have your drone registered with your Part 107 account. Once you're in the portal, go to the Part 107 dashboard. Then you scroll to the waivers section, click Create Part 107 Waiver or Authorization. It will ask you what sort of authorization or waiver you want. Select Operational Waiver and then hit Start Application. At the top, it's going to ask you for an operation title. You can call it whatever you want. Just know this is how you will find your application later and keep track of it. You'll need to fill out all of the information about the responsible party and the mailing address. You don't have to include pilot information. They have that down there a little bit, but I included it in mine just to be thorough. Next, you would put in your risk mitigation plan. And for this, I simply said, risk mitigations are covered in my application document that I will attach in step 4. The way I see it, the process of preparing happens offline, and then the Drone Zone portal is used basically just to submit the application. And then in the rest of this section of the application, you'll put in your operation parameters, what dates you want the waiver for, 90 days out and for as long as possible, proposed location, class G, proposed max altitude, 400 feet AGL, and any other existing waivers that you want attached to this waiver. On the next screen, you'll put in your drone information, and since you already have your drone registered with this account, you simply select the drone and click Next. And you'll go to their step 4, where you can review all of the information you've filled out so far to ensure it's accurate. This is also the step where you add your attachments, so the waiver application document and the ParaZero ASTM compliance documentation. Add those attachments, and then you can submit your application. Now we're going to go into some of the specifics for information to include in your application. So first, have sections in your application that will allow the reviewer to look through it quickly and understand the various pieces of information that you're trying to present. Broadly, I organized my application into number 1, a cover page with basic information. Number 2, specifics of proposed operations, why, where, and how I want to fly over people. Number 3 for me was risk mitigation. This is where I put in the information about the ParaZero parachute system. Number 4 was further mitigations, so steps that I will follow each time I conduct an operation under this waiver. Number 5, if you have additional considerations that you want to include in your application that are unrelated to risk mitigations, that's where I think where you'd put that information. And then number 6, conclusion. On your cover page, you want to include the information for responsible person, so that would be you, I assume. Your organization, that would be your company. Personally, I highly, highly, highly recommend applying for this waiver as an organization or a company, because this waiver is an umbrella for my organization, for my company, that allows me to be able to have other Part 107 operators operate underneath this waiver. Your address, your phone number, and your email. And the FAA says in their materials that it's important that both email address and phone number are valid, because they may need to contact you, and if they can't, your waiver will be denied. Next on your cover page, you would have regulation subject to waiver, which is Part 107.39, operations over people. Number 3, SUAS, or your drone, make, model, and registration number. Number 4, the parachute system that you're using, the make, model, and serial number. Number 5, your start and end date. What I would suggest is you put your start date 90 days out from right now, because they say that it can take up to 90 days to process this application. So I put mine at 91 days from the day that I was submitting the application, and then said in the specifics, if this waiver is granted, please allow for the start date to be as early as possible and to be for as long as possible. That covers the bases, and that makes it so that I can get the most value out of this. Also, weirdly, the drone portal only allowed me to apply for a waiver for up to 3 years, but they say in their materials that you can apply for up to 4. So in my actual written application, I included the dates for 4 years out. And then on the portal, I had to put in 2022, but my waiver is granted until 2023. 6, proposed area of operations, Class G airspace. For this application, it doesn't matter if you want to operate in B, C, or D airspace. Right now, this application, this waiver, is for Class G airspace. The way that the FAA approaches waivers is to grant them for Class G airspace, and then later on, you can apply for airspace authorizations, either specific or wide area authorizations, on the Drone Zone portal. And when you apply for those, you can attach waivers, whatever kind of waiver it is, whether it's a daylight waiver or an operations over people waiver. So for this application, you want to apply for Class G airspace in the United States National Airspace. Now that I have this waiver, I plan on applying for some specific airports that are near me so that I can use this waiver in a Class B airspace that's nearby. But you have to have the waiver first before you can do that. Proposed operations. First, I included a description of proposed operations. So I started this section by indicating in conversational language that I was requesting a Part 107.39 waiver in order to safely conduct operations over people. The justification for granting this waiver is that it's inevitable that drones will be flown over people, and it would be far better if those drones are flown over people by remote pilots who are following the rules and intentionally keeping safety in mind while they're doing so. And that the more people who are granted these waivers, the less there will be non-waivered operations, because companies that are hiring drone operators would vastly prefer, most companies would vastly prefer to hire somebody who can do the operation completely legally. I also included in this section a little bit about my safety record as a Part 107 operator. So I received my Part 107 certificate 2 weeks after Part 107 was implemented, and with hundreds of operations under Part 107, I've not had a single safety incident. Number three and number four were both risk mitigation. Number three is about the ParaZero system, because that is the primary reason why this waiver can be granted. So this is gonna be information that is in the ParaZero documentation as well, but it's good to have it laid out right here. And again, remember, because you cannot copy and paste things, I don't cover every single detail in this video. And so just make sure you go deeper on your application than what you find in the video. Okay, back to the video. So risk mitigation steps included in this waiver request. The SUAS to be used for waivered operations is a DJI Mavic 2 Pro, a system weighing less than 2.53 pounds, including the parachute system, and it will be equipped with a ParaZero SafeAir ASTM professional kit, which has been tested and compliant with ASTM F332218, which in the event of an SUAS failure, autonomously deploys a parachute that slows the descent rate of the falling system to 12.9 feet per second. That's documented on page 18 of ParaZero's documentation. Allows for manual deployment of the system. That is documented under page 9. Mechanically stops the rotating blades. Page 9, section 5.8.4. Includes an audio buzzer that warns bystanders of a falling SUAS. And that's in ParaZero's documentation, page 73. The size and weight of the SUAS combined with the ParaZero SafeAir ASTM kit is a system that if failure occurs, does not pose risk of any serious injury to non-participants below. The version of ParaZero SafeAir Mavic being used has been tested and found to comply with ASTM F3322-18. The testing of the system, according to standard, confirmed three main points. The SafeAir system works properly and reliably in all failure scenarios. A Mavic 2 equipped with the SafeAir system has a descent rate of 12.9 feet per second. The Mavic Air equipped with the system and flown over people should maintain a minimum flight altitude of 62.7 feet. The reason for the 62.7 feet, I just applied for 63 feet. That's the height at which the system in all of the tests can be fully deployed and have slowed the descent rate of the drone to safe levels. The attached ASTM compliance documentation includes details of how these tests were performed, as well as analysis and footage of each and every one of them. This is in SafeAir Mavic ASTM documentation, pages 19 to 63. In addition to the above provisions, all waivered operations will also include the RPIC will be aware of all provisions of this waiver and will operate within the parameters of it, that a site inspection will be conducted by the RPIC prior to waivered operations. This will allow the RPIC to identify any potential hazards to the safety of an operation, such as power lines or structures. All operations under this waiver will use a secured takeoff and landing zone, and the airspace directly above this secured area is where the SUAS will transit from takeoff to at least 63 feet AGL. That allows you to get up to the height that's necessary to then be able to fly over people. All operations under this waiver will be conducted above 63 feet, so here's where we go into those specifics. The minimum altitude allowed to give sufficient time for deployment of the parachute system. Prior to conducting any operations under this waiver, the ParaZero system will be inspected to ensure that, as best as possible, there are no known defects in the system. A visual inspection, that the system's firmware is up to date, that the battery will be sufficiently charged, and the parachute will have been packed by the manufacturer within the previous 2 years. This is all part of being F3322 compliant, that if a repack is required, the date and certified repacking entity will be recorded to maintain that compliance. What would happen in the event of signal loss? That the drone will return safely to the secure takeoff and landing zone, GPS guided and sensor guided, return to home capabilities, including precision landing capabilities. And the SUAS's return to home altitude will be set to ensure that it's always above 63 feet AGL, so that if it does fly over people, it will still be within that threshold for the parachute to be safely deployed. The remote pilot will use telemetry data that is sent from the UAS to the ground station to maintain awareness of position, altitude, attitude, and movement. RPIC will abort the operation if at any point there are unpredicted safety hazards or emergencies, and will return to the secure takeoff landing zone as best as possible, avoiding overflight of non-participants. And whenever possible, the return flight will be controlled directly by the RPIC to ensure the safest route possible. During all wavered operations, to ensure proper functioning of the ParaZero SafeAir system, SUAS will not be flown in sports mode. That I would include a repair and maintenance schedule for all equipment used under the operations, that the equipment would be stored in temperature controlled environments, that prior to any operations conducted under the waiver, that an inspection would be made of all the systems, that propellers would be inspected, and that replaced if any defect is found, and four, that batteries for the SUAS will be inspected prior to operations and replaced if any defect is found. So these are specific things to the equipment to lower the chances of equipment having malfunctions during an operation. Section 5 of my waiver application had the purpose of trying to get out of needing a visual observer, but once I received the actual waiver and read through it, it said all operations conducted under this waiver must utilize a visual observer. So I'm not free of that consideration. I did say at the end of the section that if it is deemed necessary to include a visual observer for safe operations under this waiver, I have provisions and safety measures that I have drafted and can include in this application. So I guess those provisions are what I do need to use. Visual observer, that you have communication with the visual observer, that the visual observer is familiar with the operation, with the waiver, and is able to follow the provisions of the waiver and give you, as the RPIC, the information that you need to be able to safely conduct operations under this waiver. And then for my conclusion, my primary concern is to be able to conduct operations under this waiver while maintaining safe operating conditions. If deficiencies are found, I request that they be brought to my attention and a request for clarification or additional mitigations be made before this waiver application is denied. So let me just say, this video is specifically about applying for the waiver application, but I'd like to also make a second video that is about the ParaZero system, how to set up your system to be ASTM compliant. You need to have a means for manual deployment of the parachute system, for example. And that's not something that's included in the ParaZero system on its own. You have to get a separate device that will deploy it and a separate receiver that will be attached to your drone and plugged into the parachute system. Basically, in my next video, I'm going to have that information. I'll also probably kind of have it be a little bit of an unboxing and a review video. Overall, I'm very, very happy with this system. It does exactly what I need it to do. By having this system, it made it so that I could apply for the waiver and receive it pretty easily. Now, as a Part 107 remote pilot, I can operate my drone under the provisions of the waiver over people, both safely and legally, and now I'm able to get more shots than I used to be able to. So something really cool about this video is actually that ParaZero set me up with a coupon code for my viewers. So that coupon code is BlueMantle50, and it will save you $50 on any ASTM system. So go ahead and use that if you're planning on getting this waiver. Use that code and save yourselves a little bit of money. So, I know this was a long video. If you're still here, thank you for sticking through. This is still a YouTube channel that I am passionate about and I would like to continue working on and continue growing. So please leave a comment or click the like button or the subscribe button. It really does help. Keep an eye out for the next video on the ParaZero system, and that will go into more detail about how to set up the system, things that you need to keep in mind for using it to be ASTM compliant. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next one.